Anyway, we have a lot of illness going around, so you may notice that we do have a few people missing, not only from our praise team, but also members of our congregation. And to y'all, I just want to encourage those extra prayers for all of the people we know who are sick, because I know that God, He's a God who heals. We are temples of the Lord, and illness has no place in these bodies that God designed for us. We are fearfully and wonderfully made, and I have faith in perfect and complete recovery for all. Amen? And one of the best things we can do for our bodies is to get adequate rest. So we're in luck because today, right here, right now, this is our special day of rest. And Hashem created this Sabbath day for us so that we could rest in Him and recharge and refocus and redirect our lives and our focus back towards Him. So let's just set aside all the craziness that is our lives and forget about our own inner dialogue so we can just focus on Him alone, the one who made us. Focus on His word and allow it to work in our hearts this morning. Amen? So we're going to sing. We're going to start with a Hebrew prayer. It's a prayer for peace because we trust in the Prince of Peace, who is Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen? And the prayer goes, grant us goodness, life, kindness, mercy, and compassion over us and over the whole house of Israel, and pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And these are beautiful words, so let's sing them with conviction and from the heart as we worship Him this morning. Amen?
Thank you.
Be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may enter. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates. Be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may enter. Who is he? This King of glory. He is the Lord strong and mighty. Amen. He is the King of glory. And so we're called this morning to open up the gates of our hearts so that the Almighty can reside within us. Amen.
Thank you.
hungry. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, on account of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you will be able to discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. Amen.
Thank you.
have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving devotion, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash me clean of my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. And scripture tells us that God removes our sin. He will remove our sin as far as the east is from the west, like it never existed. If we turn back to him, if we make teshuva, if we cry out to Yeshua, we will be saved. We will be free. Amen.
Psalms 86, 9 through 13 tells us, All the nations you have made will come and bow before you, O Lord, and they will glorify your name. For you are great and perform wonders. You alone are God. Teach me your ways, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart, that I may fear your name. I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. For great is your loving devotion to me. You have delivered me from the depths of Sheol.
Thank you. morning. I was told to make sure I actually looked at the announcements this morning before I got up here. I want to remind everybody of a couple of things real quick. One is that we have a sign-up sheet for the movie I Still Believe. If you would like to go to that movie, if you'll sign up, that will and we'll get it taken care of so that you'll have a seat for the showing. It's only going to be here for a few days, and so we want to get you to sign up for that. Also, we're having our Purim service joined by Freedom Church on March 9th. We need volunteers to make hamantaschen. We need lots of hamantaschen. We have recipes in bags up here. Now listen, I didn't explain well last week, so let me explain a little gooder. Each of the bags have a different recipe. So if you grab a bag of recipes, you're going to have a whole lot of exactly the same recipe. So pull some from each of the varieties and practice making hamantaschen before the ninth, so that you make sure that they're good. If you need people to assist with sampling, let us know. We will connect you with people that are willing to take one for the team. So please see Leah about that. We also have the recipes over there. We need a few more greeters. If you're interested in being a greeter, also see Leah. You have to be a member of our synagogue in good standing. And you have to be someone who can be here before service starts and stay until after service is over. I know that seems like a stretch, but I think some of you could do it. The Ancient Hebrew Scroll Project will be here on the 26th. We have flyers for that. We would like you to hand those out, let people know. Keep praying at 2:22 in the afternoon for our Vacation Torah School. Sign-up sheets for text message are available also on the table over here. Baya meets tomorrow at 4 p.m. for Bible study. For those that don't know who Baya is, you probably aren't the right age group. That's for young people 13 to 16. Huh? That's what I said. Oh, they're studying Romans chapter 13 through 16. Okay, I can see it now. Thank you. Mentoring, our men's meeting. This is for adult men only. That means grown up. At 6 p.m. tomorrow, bring food. Last time we had an amazing array of edibles. Monday night at 6 p.m. is the God and Government class with Sam. Please come if you're able to. Next Shabbat is the Bay Youth Group, Youth Night. Next Sunday, March 8th at 4 p.m. is Bay Game Night with a campfire and Mexican-style dinner at the Nichols home. For more information about the event, and what to bring, see Catherine, Hosanna, or Jacob. This is a fifth Shabbat, so there is no Hebrew class or membership class today. That will continue again next week. It's first and third weeks, Shabbats of the month. I think that's all of the announcements I have to make. Oh, don't forget, there's about 9 more days. Don't buy it today. It's Shabbat, but there's about 9 more days left to buy the T-shirt. Do we have a picture of it? Yes. We need nursery volunteers. If you think someone would be good at that, volunteer them for them.
Oh, no.
And just let us know at the office. Okay, this is to raise money for our young people to go to the youth conference, youth retreat. It says, Rabbi, the definition, one who teaches by dissecting the Bible and the subject with equal precision. See also cat herder and concrete plower. So you do not have to be a rabbi to buy the T-shirt. Somebody asked me that. I've seen a lot of you with like Alabama football shirts or Auburn football shirts or fishing shirts and stuff. And I know none of you do that stuff. So... you can buy the shirt, support the young people. I do want to say we had somebody, And it was a real blessing. He doesn't want to be known who it is, but somebody from outside of our congregation. As a matter of fact, not only is he outside of our congregation, he's not even a believer in Yeshua yet. He attends a Chabad house in another city, and he saw our ad on the Facebook. On Facebook. I just like to see the young people go, oh, he's so old. So they saw the ad on Facebook. He text messaged me and said, how much money do you need to raise to send your young people to the conference? And I told him how much. It was about $5,700 total. It's about $230 a young person. And he sent $400 to sponsor a couple of kids. And then he texted me this morning and he said, have you raised all the money yet? And I said, well, I won't know until after today's, we get done today. And he said, well, contact me back if you need some more. So listen, if a not yet believing in Yeshua person wants to bless our young people and make sure they go to the conference, then I think all of us that do believe should do everything that we can. I know everybody can't just write a check for $400 like Catherine could, but some of you can give $5, $10, help with different things. So please support our young people. This is one of the most impactful things they do every year, and every one of them comes back changed by the Ruach when they get back from this conference. So please do that, and we appreciate your support of our young people. I wanted to remind you of one last thing before we invite Ed to come up and lead liturgy, and that is that this year we are not having a large community Passover Seder. Who said awe? This is not the first time I made this announcement. Okay. So anyhow, instead we're encouraging each family to invite folks to their home and have a Passover Seder at your home, similar to the one that it actually talks about in the Bible. So it will give you an opportunity to share with them, to lead your own Seder. I'm going to be doing a class for all those who have never led a Seder so that you'll know how to lead a Seder so you can be comfortable in your discomfort. And we are also going to be providing Haggadot to each family. So you'll have a Haggadah to follow. You'll have a time to be taught how to lead a Seder. And then you'll be able to lead a Seder at your home. I think that this will allow more people to have a more intimate instruction and experience than having a large group. When you have 400 people in a room, it's not the same as when you have people that you already know and have a relationship with that you're sharing in a more intimate way. Amen? So with that said, we also know that there are people within our community that do not have family here. You know, single people anyhow. So we want to make sure that those people have opportunity to have Seder somewhere. So we're going to have a sign-up sheet for next week so that you can put, you know, the Nichols family, and we can seat four people at our Seder. And then there'll be space for four people to write in who's going to go to those Seders so that everybody has a place to go. We are not encouraging, listen to the way I say this, on the first night of Passover. Now, you can do all the Seders you want to. Lots of times we have 5, 6, 7 Seders going on during that week. On the first night, during this time that we're trying to reach out to other people, we are not encouraging 3 and 4 families from the congregation to all get together at somebody's house together to have Seder, because that undoes the whole purpose of what we're trying to do with this. So you're welcome to have. Last year, I think I went to 6 different Seders over the Passover time. And where's Gordon? Is he here still? I think they may have left. You want to invite Gordon to your Seder. He brings a case of wine with him. I'm just kidding. So anyhow, have seders, have as many as you want. Use them all we can to build community and do that. But the first night, we want to make sure that you have opportunity to invite people that are not yet familiar with seder, people that you've been sharing with, Jewish people that you've been sharing with, and non-Jewish people you've been sharing with, so they can experience it in an intimate way with your family. Amen? Let's all stand. We're so thankful that Ed was stuck here for one more week. And he's going to lead us in our liturgy. Now, let me say this before he begins, real quickly. Ed is leading the liturgy this morning. When I say that, that means you're supposed to follow him. So if he does a different version of the prayer than you're used to, that still means you're supposed to follow him. That doesn't mean you're supposed to sing it the way you know it louder in hopes that he will adjust to you. Okay? So we thank you for that.
Shabbat shalom. Hallelujah. Together with boldness and a boldness and courage to proclaim Messiah Yeshua as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This morning we sing songs to him. Together and with joy you shall draw forth water from the fountains of salvation. Ushaftem mayim besason mimaneha Yeshua. Shaftem mayim besason mimaneha Yeshua. Mayim, 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 he mayim besason. Mayim, 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 he mayim besason. He, 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 mayim, 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 mayim besason. Mayim, 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 mayim besason. How lovely are your tents, O Jacob, your dwelling places, O Israel. O Lord, through your abundant kindness, I will enter your house, and I will bow and down to your holy sanctuary. O Lord, I love the house where you dwell and the place where your glory resides. I shall prostrate myself and bow and bend the knee before the Lord, my Maker. As for me, may my prayers to you, O Lord, be at the right time. O God, in your abundant righteousness, answer me with the truth of your salvation. Amen. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One.
Bless the Lord, the Blessed One,
all eternity. Baruch et Adonai Hamavorach.
Baruch Adonai Hamavorach Le'olam Vaed.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work.
For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. That is why the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Speak also unto the children of Israel, saying, above all my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you.
Hallelujah.
The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord.
Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat, lasot et ha-Shabbat, ledorotam berit olam, veshamru. Nei Israel et ha-Shabbat, lasot et ha-Shabbat, ledorotam berit olam. Bnei Uvein, Bnei Israel, Bnei Israel, Oti le'olam, Veshamru, Bnei Israel, Shabbat, lasot et ha-Shabbat, ledorotam berit olam. Ki sheshet yamim asah Adonai et ha-shamayim ve'et ha-aretz. Ve'shamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat, lasot et ha-Shabbat, ledorotam berit olam. Uvayom ha-shvi, Shabbat vayinafash, Shabbat vayinafash, Shabbat vayinafash. Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat, lasot et ha-Shabbat, ledorotam berit olam.
Hallelujah. Blessing of Messiah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah, Yeshua. Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Asher natan lanu derech ha-Yeshua, b'mashiach Yeshua. Amen.
Please rise for the Shema.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai.
Glorious kingdom for all eternity.
Amen.
And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And you have these words which I command you this day be upon your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and speak of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, when you retire, and when you arise. And you shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and let them be frontlets between your eyes. And you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Ve'ahavt et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levavecha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha ve'hayu hadavarim ha'ele asher anochi metzavecha hayom ha'levavecha ושיננתם לבניך ודיברת בם בשבתך בביתך ובלכתך בדרך ובשכבך ובקומך וקשתם לאות הידיך והיו לטוטפות בין עיניך וכתבתם על המזוזות ביתך ובשעריך ואהבת לרעך כמוך.
מי כמוך, פט 51-52. מי כמוך
of the loss of a loved one, please remain standing for the mourner's kaddish. If you are not standing, please take note of those who are and make sure that you reach out to them this week and bless them and pray for them, support them, send them a note or a card or something to let you know, let them know that you are praying and thinking about them. Magnified and sanctified be his great name in the world which he has created according to his will. May he establish his kingdom during your life and during your days and during the life of the whole house of Israel, even swiftly and soon, and say, Amen. Let his great name be blessed forever and to all eternity. Blessed, praised, and glorified, exalted, extolled, and honored, magnified and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed is he. Though he be high above all the blessings and songs, praises and consolations which are uttered in the world, and say, Amen. May there be abundant peace from heaven and life upon us and upon all Israel, and say, Amen. May he who makes peace in his high places make peace upon us and upon all Israel, and say, Amen. Yid gadal v'yid kadash shmei rabah. Be'alma divrak yirtei v'yamlich malchutei. B'chayachon of Yomachon of Chaye de Kol Beit Yisrael. B'agalav Yisman Kari Vimru. Amen. Yeheshmei Rabban Vavarach Le'elam Olom Elmaya. Yit Barach V'yish Tabach V'yit Pa'ar V'yit Romam V'yit Naseh. V'yit Hadar V'yit Alei V'yit Alal Shmei de Kudusha B'richu. Le'elam In Kol Berchata V'shirata. Tush B'chata V'nechemata Damiran Ba'alma Vimru. Amen. Yeheshlam Rabba Min Shemai V'chaim Aleinu V'al Kol Yisrael V'imru. Amen. Osei Shalom B'mromav Hu Yaseh Shalom Aleinu V'al Kol Yisrael V'imru. Amen. Now, if we will all stand one more time. And if the children will make their way to the front. We have the most amazing, the most wonderful, the happiest, the most loving, the best behaved, the most excited to be going to their class. Children in the whole world. Just a moment ago, you in the back didn't see it, but Wyatt was up front, and his beautiful little sister, just as I said, the most loving, she just went around him and just kind of went, I'm up front. And then Wyatt heard the words loving, and as he reached out to strangle, he said, nope, I can't do that. I'm just kidding, he did not reach out to strangle her, but he was very loving, wasn't he? Will? We do have amazing young people. Vayhi bin Saharon, Vayomer Moshe, Kum Adonai, Veyafutsu Oyvecha, Veyanusu Misanecha, Mipanecha, Ki Mitzion, Te.
Torah, Torah.
B'Kdushato. When the ark would travel, Moses would say, Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them that hate you flee from before you. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who in his holiness gave the Torah to his people Israel. Amen. I know that periodically, as the children make their way to the alcove so that we can pray over them, some people think, boy, this is taking a long time. And I just think, yay. I love the fact that it takes a little bit of time for all of our young people. And matter of fact, if it took longer, it wouldn't bother me. We are just so blessed to have such amazing young people. So let's raise our hands and pray over them. Abba, Father, we thank you for each and every one of these young people and for their parents. And Father, we speak blessings into their hearts, into their lives. May these young people... I can spit it back out if you want. Oh, for the days of simplicity when walking on one step was exciting. If I can just walk on that step, my life will be complete. Amen. This week's parasha is Parashat Terumah. It's found in Exodus chapter 21, beginning at verse 25, beginning at verse 1. The blessing is found on page 65 in your siddur and should also be on the wall behind me. Baruch Hu et Adonai Hamavorach. Baruch Adonai Hamavorach Le'olam Va'ed. Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Hamim V'natan Lanu et Torato. Baruch Ata Adonai Noten HaTorah. Amen. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all peoples and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Vayidaber Adonai el Moshe l'amor, deber el b'nei Yisrael, vayichu li, terumah me'et kol ish asher, yidvenu livo, Tikhu et terumati. Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, Tell B'nai Israel to take up an offering for me. From anyone whose heart compels him, you are to take my offering. These are the contributions which you are to receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet cloth, fine linen, goat hair, ram skin dyed red, seal skin, acacia wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the sweet incense, onyx stones, setting stones for the ephod and for the breastplate. Have them make a sanctuary for me that I might dwell among them. You are to make it all precisely according to everything I show you, the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the furnishings within. Just so you must make it. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu torat emet v'chaye olam natat betokenu. Baruch atah Adonai, Noten HaTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Can you pick it up? If you can't, just hold it where you can. Vezod HaTorah Asher Samoshe Lifnei B'nei Yisrael Al Pi Adonai B'yad Moshe And this is the Torahmost place before the children of Israel by the command of the Lord through Moses' hand. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Our Haftorah reading for this morning comes from 1 Kings chapter 5, beginning at verse 26. The blessing is on page 69 in your siddur and also on the wall behind me.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher bechar b'nevi'im tovim v'ratza v'divrihem ha'ne'amarim be'emet. Baruch atah Adonai habukar b'torah u'v'moshe avdo u'v'Yisrael amo u'v'nevi'ei ha'emet v'atzedek. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who selected good prophets, were pleased with their words which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who chooses the Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and prophets of truth and righteousness. Then the king commanded, and they quarried great stones, costly stones, to lay the foundation of the house with cut stones. So Solomon's builders and Hiram's builders, along with the Gebelites, cut them and prepared the timber and the stones to build the house. Now it came to pass 480 years after the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month Ziv, which is the second month, that he began to build Adonai's house. Now the house that King Solomon built for Adonai was 60 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, zor kol ha'olamim zadik bekol hadarot, ha'el ha'ne'aman ha'omer ve'oseh ha'mdabarei umkayem shekol devarav emet v'atzedek. Ne'aman atahu Adonai Eloheinu v'ne'amanim devareka v'devar echad mitvareka kor lo shuv Kor lo yashuv rikam, ki al melech ne'aman, v'rakman atah, baruch atah Adonai ha'el ha'ne'aman bekol devarav. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, faithful in all generations, the trustworthy God who says and does, who speaks and makes it come to pass, all of whose words are true and righteous, faithful are you, O Lord our God, and faithful are your words, for not one of yours is turned back unfulfilled. For you are a faithful and compassionate God and King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is faithful in all his words.
Amen. Our Brit Chadashah reading for this morning comes from Hebrews chapter 8, beginning at verse 1. The blessing is on page 71 in your siddur.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu mashiach yeshua vehadiberot shel haberit hachadasha. Baruch atah Adonai noten haberit hachadasha. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Now here is the main point being said. We do have such a Kohen Gadol, high priest, who has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. He is a priestly attendant of the holies and the true tent, which Adonai set up, not man. For every Kohen Gadol is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices, so it is necessary for this one also to have something to offer. Now, if he were on earth, he would not be a Kohen at all, since there are those who offer the gifts according to the Torah. They offer service in a replica and a foreshadow of the heavenlies, one that is just as Moses was instructed by God when he was about to complete the tabernacle, for he says, "See that you make everything according to the design that was shown to you on the mountain." But now Yeshua has obtained a more excellent ministry insofar as he is the mediator of a better covenant which has been enacted on better promises. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher natan lanu hadevar ha-emet V'chaye olam nata betochenu Baruch ata Adonai Noten ha-berit ha-chadasha Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the word of truth and has planted life everlasting in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant.
Amen. Thank you. If we will all rise and return the Torah to the ark. Thank you. Eitz Chaim hi L'machazikim ba V'tomchecha me'ushar D'racheya d'archeinoam V'chol nativoteha shalom Hashiveinu Adonai Elecha v'na shuva Chahadesh Chahadesh Ameinu Chahadesh Ameinu Kekedem. It is a tree of life to those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all of its paths are peace. Bring us back, Lord, to you, and we shall come. Renew our days as of old. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Before I dig into the message this morning, the parasha, I wanted to say something only because of the times we live in. Some of you may have heard on the news and social media and things like that, that there is a virus attacking the world. I know it hasn't been at the forefront of everything, and many of you may not have heard about it. But there is a virus, and what's been amazing is I have seen people actually telling their congregants, stay home. Don't go to services, don't go around people, don't go to the store, don't. And I want to say this, common sense tells us to use alcohol. Now, I'm not talking about whiskey. I don't want y'all to go off the wrong thing. But, you know, wash your hands, use antimicrobial stuff, you know, use Lysol, use all those kind of things. But don't let fear control your life. Please don't get so afraid of this. Listen, more people have died during the time of this virus from texting while driving than from the virus. How many of you are willing to give your cell phone up right now? Somehow we're not as afraid of texting while driving or talking on our phone or changing the radio station as we are of coronavirus. Coronavirus there have been people that died, but statistically it's not a lot. That doesn't mean they aren't important. Every soul, every life is important. But don't let the media make you afraid. I cannot tell you how many times in my lifetime we were about to all be destroyed by a pandemic attack. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't use precautions and common sense. But don't be controlled by fear. The Bible teaches us explicitly not to fear anything but Elohim. So don't be controlled by fear. Don't let it take hold of you. More people die from things that we do all the time. Driving. More people. There was an accident on I-10 last night. Somebody was driving the wrong way on I-10 and caused an accident. There's more people died from accidents, but nobody's giving up their cars. Nobody's saying, okay, we need to be afraid of cars and stop driving. We have to use common sense. We should drive better. Some of you need to really drive better. But we need to use common sense, but not fear. Amen? Okay, I just wanted to say that. We'll, you know, keep up with things going on, pay attention. But fear, political and media fear tends to be a great mechanism for them to keep us from knowing what's really going on. And so just don't get caught up in fear. It's just not good. I'm also thankful that our video seems to be working today. I was watching the news this week twice on the news. I was watching CNN, and once I was watching Fox, and both times they had technical difficulties. And they have all the money in the world to spend on their equipment and their technology. So it makes me feel a little better when some of our technology doesn't quite work all the time the way we want it to, because these guys have all kinds of money, and they still end up with, you know, glitches and things that happen. So it's just when it happens, everybody looks at the technology people and goes, what's wrong with you? It's not them. Usually it's the equipment. Sometimes it's them. But usually it's the equipment. Right, Lincoln? Okay. I appreciate Lincoln. The only job that's less thanked is the technology. From that is the nursery. So we appreciate the people that work in the nursery. Anyhow, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to chapter 25 of the book of Exodus, Parsha Terumah. By the way, I appreciate those that read. We always need volunteers to read our parashot on Shabbat. If you're a member of the congregation and you want to be added to that list, see Leah. She will add you to the list and let you know when your turn is and give everybody the honor to read Adonai's word. Amen? Okay, Adonai spoke to Moses saying, tell Bnei Israel to take up an offering for me from anyone whose heart compels him. You are to take an offering. You know, when I read this the first time, I've done these parashot for a few years, and this happens to be my favorite parsha of all the parashot that we read every year. But we've done these for quite a few years, and each time you read this, we tend to focus on this verse that says, take this offering from anybody who has a willing heart or whose heart compels them. And that's a true statement that if you're giving to the Lord, you should give from a heart that compels you to do that, and not grudgingly and not, you know, angrily or I don't want to do this, but give. I was teaching at Freedom Church this week. I'm doing a 6-week series at Freedom, and I'm teaching Hebrew. By the way, Freedom Church, over 80 people signed up to take the Hebrew class at Freedom Church. Isn't that amazing? And more than that were in the class that I was teaching, but I was teaching on Shabbat, and someone said during the question and answer time, well, what if you just don't feel like doing Shabbat? What if you just don't feel like, what if you, you know, and I said, look, if you do anything for Adonai without the right heart, you're robbing yourself of the blessing of doing it for him. That doesn't mean I'm telling you not to keep Shabbat because you're grouchy that day, but I'm saying we have to do things from a willing heart, from a heart that compels us to do it. We should wake up in the morning looking forward to coming to Shabbat service and looking forward to enjoying our Shabbat. We should enter in of our day of preparation looking forward to our Erev Shabbat gathering, our meal, our time with our family, our time of devotion to Him. It should be something that our hearts compel us to do. It's kind of like, I used to watch my kids. Now, I got married when I was 19. I don't say honestly that, because I honestly did, but that's not the point. I'm honestly. But I didn't date a whole lot of people because I had, you know, I was 17 or 16. I went in the Navy, and then I got out the Navy, and 19, I got married, and there wasn't a whole lot of time where I was around people, so I dated a couple people, but I don't have a whole lot of experience in that part of things. I've been married for almost 39 years to Pammy, but I didn't just date a bunch of people and break up, and part of that was that in my mind, I didn't want to date people for long because everybody that I knew that was married had broke up, and I thought this is just a dumb thing to do. And I didn't want to get tied up with somebody who was going to get half my stuff. And even though I only had a little stuff, it was still mine. I didn't want to give away. So I didn't date a lot out of that. I'm just being honest with you. You know, in 1980 or so, my parents had been divorced. Everybody around me had been divorced. My uncles and aunts had been, most of them had been divorced. It was like, this is just a bad trend. I just as soon not do that. So I just didn't date a whole lot of people. I was young. I also thought that before you dated and wanted to get married, you should actually have some money in the bank and some place to live and stuff like that. And I knew my wife wasn't going to live in the barracks with me on the Navy base because there were other men there. So that wasn't where I was going. So I didn't do that. But I did watch my children as they prepared for dates because I couldn't watch me do it because I don't have the ability to watch me. So I watched them. And when they would prepare for dates, they would lay out their clothes and they would iron their clothes. They would get everything right. They would go take a shower and then they would come back and then they'd go take another shower and then they'd come back and then they'd get their hair all done with, this is back when they put gel on their hair. So they had the spiky kind of gel hair thing going on and they would put on cologne so they smell good and they'd get their pants just right and their shoes clean just right. They made all that preparation just to go on a date with a girl they were probably never going to see again. And then we show up for our date with Adonai in whatever we happen to be wearing, dragging in from whatever we happen to be doing, and expect that he's going to go, "Oh, wonderful, you showed up." I think there's something missing in that we need to be compelled by our heart to do for him as or better than what we would do for other people. Amen? Okay, thank you to the three of you who are with me. But that's not my message for this morning. It just was part of what was on my heart. Adonai spoke to Moses, "Take up an offering for me from anyone whose heart compels them to take an offering." Most times when people read this, preachers read this, rabbis read this, they immediately talk about tithes and offerings. I don't want to get too sidetracked on that, but I do want to say this is important, that when you're giving to the Lord tithes and offerings, you're supposed to do it from a willing heart. You're supposed to do it as your gift to Him. And although there are promises attached to our giving, we don't give for the promises. We give to give. So if you're giving because you're going to get a certain percentage increase back, you're investing, not giving. And investing's not bad, but it doesn't bring the same blessings as giving. Does that make sense? Well, that's not what I want to talk about today. What I want to talk about is what's actually taking place here, because I think it's relevant to us as believers in where we are in the world today. So here's the children of Israel. They've just left 400 years of bondage. And on the way out, the Lord says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to ask of your neighbors for them to give you gold, silver, and other things. And they bring those things out of Egypt with them. And so So Israel has served in servitude, and for about 80 years they were actually in slavery. Before that, they were just living in Egypt, but they're in bondage to Egypt when they should have been free men in Israel. And they end up being servants in Egypt, and they're not getting paid, and they're being abused, and life is really bad, and it's getting worse. And they get out, and on the way out, the Lord gives them all this stuff that they ask their neighbors for. Now, some of your Bibles will say they borrowed it, but the Hebrew word there doesn't mean to borrow. It just means to ask. And so they ask their neighbors, and because borrowing means you have some intention, at least to think about giving back. I mean, some of you don't understand borrowing because some of you have borrowed books from my library. And so I understand that you don't quite understand that borrowing has with it the idea of returning. Just a little commercial for my library. But they didn't borrow from the Egyptians with an intent to give it back. They asked of the Egyptians and they gave to them. And then they have all this stuff. Now, this is the first time they've had stuff in a long time. The first time they've had gold and silver and all the things that they had in a long time. And they come out of the out, and the Lord is speaking to them and telling them, I want your stuff. Now think about that. Think about how they might have reacted in human flesh to having nothing, suddenly having, and then immediately being asked to give that which you just got. And think about what they might have thought. I don't know about you, but I've been poor before. You know, I've been to where I struggled and where, you know, a paycheck was, okay, do I pay tithes and give offering, or do I eat? Do I pay tithes and offering, or do I have power? Do I pay tithes and offering, or do I have water? Do I pay tithes and offering, or do I pay my car payment? Or do I pay my insurance on my car? Any of those things. And there we get in this mindset, and here the children of Israel have left Egypt. We know their mindset because we hear these discussions that they're having. You just brought us out of Egypt so we could die out in the wilderness. Weren't there enough graves in Egypt? Why'd you bring us back out here just so that we'll die out here? And I can imagine in their minds, as the Lord is saying, I want you to give me that stuff I just gave to you, that some of them at least were saying, wait a minute, if we give this stuff when we get to Israel, to Canaan, what are we going to have? What are we going to do when we get there? What are we going to live off of when we get there? We have this stuff, but this is all we've got. What are we going to do when we get there? And then beyond that, they had to be saying, well, if we give it now, what are we going to do next time, he asks? And how many times is he going to ask? And are we going to have anything when we get there? And so this is what's happening here in the minds and the hearts of these children of Israel as they leave Egypt for the first time having anything. And the Lord says to take up this offering from anyone whose heart compels him, you are to take it. He says that to Moses. I think if he had spoken it from the mountain, and they heard the booming voice of the Lord from the mountain, it would have a little different thing going on. But he tells Moses to tell them. So Moses then has to go out to these people and say, look, I was talking with God, and he said he wants your stuff. Right? And there has to be in their minds and hearts a battle going on between faith and fear. Between what they would desire to do in faith and what their flesh would lead them to do in a worldly mindset. Now, this goes way beyond money and things. Because the reality is, for most of us, money is the easiest thing for us to give. I mean, we have difficulty doing it, but it's the easiest of the things we have. You don't believe that? When I was young, we used to have to sell candy for school. Do they still do that? I always thought it was interesting that they, back when I was in school, they gave you dental exams, and then sent you out to sell candy. I wasn't sure what kind of scam was going on with that. But we'd have to sell candy. My father would just, it was like back then, the parent would have to go with you as you went door to door selling candy bars. So my father would just buy the candy because it was easier for him just to write a check for whatever candy we had to buy than it was for him to go out and walk with us as we walked up to people and went, "You don't want to buy candy, do you?" It's like the other week I went to a restaurant and somebody came up, and excuse my French here. Somebody came up to me at the restaurant. I was waiting outside for some people to get there, and somebody came up and they said, "There's no way in hell you'd buy me breakfast, is there?" And I said, "It's really the wrong way to ask me." First of all, I'm not there. I'm not going there. I don't want to be there. From my understanding, they don't serve breakfast there. There's a whole lot of reasons that's not the way to ask this. And she just kind of walked away angry at me for and I would have been glad to buy her breakfast, but not in hell. That's you know. Anyhow. My father would just buy candy rather than do it. And we do that. Most of us have much more greater ease giving offerings and tithes than we have giving our lives. We have a much easier time just writing the check. I've done my part. I showed up on Shabbat. I wrote a check. The rest of the week is mine. And if I want to hold on to my attitudes and my anger and my suffering and my... I can do that because I gave my money and I showed up once a week. Some of us twice a week. Some of us are big time givers. We come three times a week. But I think this is much deeper than that. Because these are people that don't understand freedom from slavery means you become citizens of the king's kingdom. And in the king's kingdom, there's never a loss. There's never a shortage. There's never a crisis of what are we going to do? How are we going to get by? How are we going to make this happen? I cannot tell you the amount of times that Pammy and I have given our last dollar only to turn around to have somebody give us more money than we gave. Over and over. I'm talking about thousands of dollars over the 39 years she's been married to me. I can't tell you how many times that the Lord said, "I want you to do this." And we said, "Okay, Lord, I'll give of a willing heart." Our heart compels us to do this. And the result has been always more than enough. Always more than enough. But it's not about money. Listen, the reality is that most of us in this room, including myself, struggle daily with giving parts of our lives to the Lord with a willing heart. Because we're comfortable that way. We're comfortable being mad at relatives. There are a lot of people in this room that haven't seen people in their family for years because you had a fight years ago. Most of us are like the Hatfields and McCoys. We have no idea what the fight was over anymore, but we know we hate them. And we aren't willing to give that to the Lord so that He can take it from us and we can be well. And free. See, He's not asking for these things because He's short. It's not like going up, the Lord came up to Stan and said, "Look, you know, I get paid Friday, but if you can spot me $10 till then, I'd appreciate it." This isn't what happened. The Lord isn't short a dollar. He doesn't need any of this stuff. What he's doing is teaching them how to be free from bondage to things. Because they'd already been freed from bondage to servanthood, but they haven't completely been free from bondage to things. And so he gives them the opportunity to willingly give of their hearts to do this. And many of us are holding on to sin. Some of us are bound by pornography or lust or envy. I don't know how many times I've heard people get upset because somebody in the congregation got blessed and it wasn't them. And they say, well, I can't believe God blessed them. Don't you know how they live their lives? They're sinners. I want to get one of those Nerf guns so that when people say that, I can just go. We have one. I can borrow one of the youths. You know, I'm so angry. What are you angry about? Well, so-and-so got a new car. I can't believe they got a new car. God bless them with a new car. Someone just gave them a car. I can't believe they just gave them a car. And don't you know how they live? Don't you know what they said to me 12 years ago? I remember the exact words. I remember where I was and what they were wearing. We have children that are still mad at their parents for something they did years ago. Just holding it. They're just not willing to give it to the Lord. They're just not willing to give it up. My parent did this. My parent did that. Some of us, that parent's already been forgiven by the Lord. Because they repented. So they're set free and you're in bondage because of them. That's like saying to somebody, I hate you so much I want to spend eternity in hell with you. Because I'm not going to forgive you and I'm going to hold it against you and I'm going to live like the devil because you did something to me and I hate being around you so much I want to spend eternity with you. That just doesn't make sense, but we do that because we aren't willing to give all to the Lord. Some of us are holding on to sins just because they're fun. There's some things in the flesh that are just fun. We just don't want to give it up. Some of us are holding on to things because we think we did the right thing, and we're just going to hang on until it becomes the right thing. It doesn't work that way. If it's not the right thing, it's not going to become the right thing because you keep doing it longer. That's the explanation of the world. You know, it's 2020. Marriage is different now. It's 2020. This is different now. It used to be sin, but now it's not sin. No, it's still sin. Just because you do it longer doesn't make it not sin. Some of us are holding on to anger. Some of you are mad at me. Some people are watching on the video right now because they're mad at me about something I said that I have no idea that I said and I have no idea they're mad at me. Some of you may be mad at me. I have no idea you're mad at me. You've never come talk to me about it. I said something, it offended you. I'm sure I do that all the time. I'm pretty good at it. I learned sarcasm before I learned English. I know I accidentally offend people. I don't mean to. I honestly don't wake up in the morning going, you know what, I'm just going to make Lori mad at me today. There's two Loris in here. I got two for one on that one. But I don't wake up in the morning saying, let me see, what can I do to aggravate somebody today? Other than my wife, there's periods of time that I do that. But that's because, you know, she deserves it sometimes. I get in the car nearly every day. And she walks out the house. And as she walks toward the car, I put it in reverse and just back up a few inches. And then she scowls at me. And then I know she loves me. It's that endearing look that she has as she comes toward the car and I just back up that few inches and she goes poof, 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 on the car. Like that's going to make me stop. What that does is make me do it one more time. But she gets the cutest smile when I do it, and it's just worth it. Some of us are involved in sin just because it's comfortable. We've been doing it. It takes work to stop doing it. We have to actually make a choice to stop doing it. We really don't want to do that. It's just the way we are. It's how we've been. Our heart has to compel us. And what makes, remember, the heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? So if your heart compels you to do something godly, it's because God is compelling your heart to do that. Too many of us just live there. We're just not willing to give it up. We're not willing to give up our sin. We're not willing to give up those things that are contrary to the Lord. We're not willing to give up our language. I've heard some people within our community use words I didn't use as a sailor. And when you say something, you know, that's really a bad testimony. That doesn't make a difference what words you use. I hear people using bad words all the time. You're right. It doesn't unless you want to have a good witness. I want to share one more thing as I close. There are several items on this list of things that the Lord asked for. Like, in particular, it says seal skins. If you have a different Bible, it'll say something else. In this Bible, it says goat skin. Some says seal skin. Some says manatee skin. Some says porpoise. Some says badger. Some say. Now, I want you to know that most of those animals are not kosher, and most of them are not available. They're in the middle of the desert, and the Lord says, I want some seal skin. Right? They're in the middle of the desert. He says, I want some manatee skin. That's what I need. Get me some manatee skin. Okay. So these are things that are not readily available. It takes some kind of supernatural involvement to make them available. And they're also unclean. Except for the goat. And it's really not goat because there's a word for goat in Hebrew. And this isn't the word for goat. So it's really not goat. They just put goat in there to try to make it feel better because goat's a clean animal. But the word there is a word for an animal. We don't even know what it is. We have no real definition for it. We just fill in the blank with an animal we know. And they fill in a blank with an animal that's waterproof because it makes sense that the outside of the tent would be waterproof. So we just kind of fill in the blank with an unknown. Here's the thing. I believe, this is my belief, this is not something I can point to in Scripture, but I believe that God purposely chose an animal that He created for that moment in time to do that one thing. I think that part of God giving us stuff so that we can give is a supernatural component. That He provides for us things that we don't have any access to so that we can give to Him that which we don't have the ability to make or have. But here's the thing. You still have to be willing to give that. In other words, you have to be willing to give that which you were given to Him, even if it doesn't make sense. And the other thing is this. If it was an unclean animal, it speaks so beautifully to His ability to take that which was unclean, interact with it supernaturally, so that it can become part of His tabernacle and serve a purpose in His kingdom. Listen when I say this, because that wasn't just an add-on to my message, but that's actually my message. If you want to be used by Him for His kingdom, if you want to be part of His tabernacle, if you want to be what that is, you have to be willing to give Him from a willing heart that which makes you unclean. Sometimes it is greed. Sometimes it's just what this passage says in the plain text. Are you willing to give me your money? Are you willing to dig into your bank account and do this? Are you willing to do that with a trust that no matter how much you give, it's never going to cause you to do without because I'm faithful to provide for you? Are you willing to do that? But I think it goes further than that because he's not just asking for money. Part of what he's asking for are things that are unclean. I think that's you and me. I think it's us. I think part of the giving is giving us. God created you unique. You are the only you there is. You are the only one that will ever be a you. Just like whatever this was. God supernaturally made a Jerry. I have no idea why, but he did. And no one else will be Jerry. No one in history will ever be Jerry. Jerry was born in sin, shapen in iniquity. He was an unclean thing that God interacted with supernaturally so that he could be made clean to be used in his kingdom. But the process required the willingness of Jerry's heart to give himself to the Lord as an offering so that that could happen in his life. And I'm telling you, that doesn't just happen when we first come to faith, but that is a continuing process as he sanctifies us, as we draw closer to him, and he asks us over and over, are you willing to give this as an offering? Are you willing to give this? Are you willing to give your anger at your family, your anger at your parents, your anger at the boss who fired you, the anger at that car that broke down, the anger at that bank that ripped you off, the anger at whoever hurt you, the anger at that pastor, that rabbi, that person that offended you, the anger at that person that abused you, the anger at your ex-husband, your ex-wife, their ex-husband, their ex-wife, whoever's involved in your life, are you willing to give that up to him as a sacrifice so that he can make you clean so that you can be part of his tabernacle? And today I want you to think about that because I promise you that there's not a person in this room that doesn't have something that right now Adonai is saying, give this to me with a willing heart. If you do, I'm going to take care of you. You don't have to use that anger as a crutch. I know that many of us deal with that. I hurt my foot the other week. I don't know how. It hurt for a long time. I know some of you asked me this morning, Rabbi, why are you limping? I'm limping not because I hurt my foot. My foot feels completely better right now. I'm limping because I walked funny for so long because I hurt my foot that now my leg hurts everywhere else. Okay, my hurt foot caused me to walk different. And I'm telling you that whatever it is that hurts in you, whatever it is that you're holding that way, whatever you knew that's damaged is causing you to walk funny. And God wants to straighten out your walk today. And all he's asking is, just give it to me. Just give it to me. Just set it on the altar. Give it to me and let me burn it up so that you can be pure and holy and righteous before me. Let's all stand. Abba, Father, I just ask right now that if there's anyone in this room, and I know there are because, Father, I know the people that you have here and I know some of the things that go on in their lives, some of the things they've dealt with, some of the struggles they've talked to me about even this week. And Father, I ask that you would just help them right now. Wherever they are, whatever it is, to give it right now as a terumah, as an offering. Let you burn it up. Let you take care of it. Let you set them free from that. Abba, there are those that are struggling with lust and greed and pornography and, Father, anger and jealousy, rage, broken relationships, families that are torn. Father, those that are involved in adultery and fornication and all kinds of uncleanliness, those that are consumed by alcohol addiction and drug addiction and other substances that they allow to control their lives, Father, let them this morning place it on the altar so that you can make them the unique creation you designed them to be, that they would be clean, holy, and righteous to be part of your tabernacle, your kingdom, your people. Father, that they would have a testimony to share of your greatness, your freedom. Abba, help us to be real with you this morning. Take away the facade. Take away the fake. Take away the pretend. And let us be broken before you. Let us just be real and pour out our hearts to you, Father. Those hurts, those things, those bondages, that we would be made free in Yeshua's name. Because he who the Son sets free, he who the Son makes free, is free indeed. B'shem Yeshua Meshachenu. Amen. Amen. Remember, directly after the Aaronic benediction, Ronald is going to lead us in Kiddush and Motzi, and then directly after that, just make your way into the fellowship hall. Those that are 70 and above, please go to the front of the line, as well as our first-time visitors, and all of the rest of the young people, get in line behind them. Yevarech Adonai Ve'yishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai panav elecha, vichunecha. Yisar Adonai panav elecha, ve'yasem lecha shalom. Adonai bless you and keep you. Adonai make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Adonai lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. B'shem Yeshua Meshachenu Sar Shalom, in the name of Yeshua our Messiah, the Prince of Peace. Amen, amen. If you're a first-time visitor and you filled out that visitor's card, if you would bring it up and hand it to me and introduce yourself, that would be great. Also, if you are going to do anything at the Tzedakah box, if you do it on your way to the fellowship hall so that we can take care of that, And please, please just remain still until he doesn't need it. Please just remain still till after Kiddush and Motzi.
Okay, and all together now. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Creator of the fruit of the vine.
Amen.
Okay, and all together now. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, brings bread from the earth and bread of life, Messiah Yeshua. Amen.